Yeah, so welcome to the presentation about kernel workqueues. My name is Petr Mládek. I'm kernel developer working on kernel live patching infrastructure and printk. And also I'm interested in watchdogs and workqueues and that kthread worker API. And stuff like this. Okay, so the aim of this presentation is to explain the basic design of workqueues so that if you need to use them or you see to use them or you need to debug them, then you might get the feel how they are supposed to work and what you should choose what you should expect actually to see. Okay, yeah, next slide. So I will start with explanation what workqueues are for. Then I will try to explain the design on some diagrams. I consider this the most important part of the presentation. Then I will talk about the API, but not in details, just about that interesting things. And it will be related to the previous design explanation. And then some short summary. Okay, so let's start with the purpose. Kernel has to do some things in normal context, which means like normal process context. It's needed, for example, when it has to do something asynchronously or when there is something non-trivial that is triggered from atomic context and it has to offload it to normal context. So in the very old solution was that soft interrupt, but it's not a good context because it can be scheduled and stuff like this. So the right solution are some real processes, and kernel is able to create your own processes, which are called kthreads. You could implement your own one. There is an API for this, and it's usually some main loop where the kthread is waiting for something to do, and when it happens, then it processes it and then waits again. And you could implement it by some low-level scheduler API, and I have seen a lot of mistakes there, like races, or if you need to actually special handle system freeze, or if you actually have to handle like stopping or destroying the kthread there, you need to take care of it and it's easy to make a mistake. So for this, there is that workqueues API that actually implements, that provides some special kthreads that run some generic loop, and anyone could queue there any work, which means some like callback that should be proceed in that kthreads. And so it's not just about to making it easier to implement this, but it's also about make it efficient and actually for the system, because there are many subsystems that need to use kthreads, and if they all create their own kthreads, then the system might be like overloaded, it might get out of free bits, or there might be a lot of processes that will be idle most of the time, which is not effective. So this is where that workqueues help, because they use some shared pool pools of workers that might be used, that are ready for use, and it could even start new ones when needed, and or balance the number of kthreads. Okay, but it the workqueues have some limitations because that workers are shared, so the users sometimes are blocked by other users of these workers, or also the setting of that process priority and scheduling is limited. So sometimes you need your own dedicated kthreads. And if you don't want to implement that using that low-level scheduler API, then I suggest to use that kthread worker API, which is similar to workqueues. It should be much easier to do, and it should do the right thing in most situations. And the main difference is that actually it creates your own kthreads that you might even set your own scheduling policy affinity and so on. And they are always there for you. So that's the introduction. And now let's go to the design. Let's start first with use terms. Work item is a simple structure that includes a pointer to some function to the callback that should be proceed when this work item is put into the queue. Delayed work is a more complex structure that includes the normal work item and plus timer that can be set, and when it fires, then it actually queues the normal work in the queue to be proceed. Then there are worker threads, also called workers, that are the special kthreads that have the generic loop, and they process the queued work items. Then there are worker pools that every worker pool is a group of workers that have the same CPU affinity and process priority. And so there are a lot of pools in the system on each CPU, on each, for each NUMA node, and also another pools that might have even more like limited CPU affinity, like just part of the NUMA node. And finally, there is a workqueue, which is, I would say, just some virtual queue that where you could specify some parameters that somehow affect how that queue works, I proceed. And actually, when I think about it, then it's not really FIFO, like, because the processes can be proceed in not in a random random order, but it's possible that actually some later queued work might get proceed earlier, and you will see why in a minute. Okay, so let's look at the design. And I will show it on some diagrams. So we have a workqueue called A, and we have this one will be a bound workqueue, which is the default, and it uses per CPU worker pools. And And if you queue any work into this workqueue, then it will be proceed on the same CPU where it was queued, which is usually more efficient than if you would have your own kthread somewhere in the system. And so now you have to somehow connect that workqueue with that worker pools. And internally, there is another structure which is called pool workqueue, which is very confusing with explanation of the others, workqueues and worker pools. So I will call it pwqueue, and it's also the name of the variable that is used everywhere in the sources. And this structure is actually important in the designs. You will see it later. This is why I show it here. So if you have another workqueue, then it has their own pwqueue structures, and it might be connected to the same worker pools. In this case, this is another bound worker pool that might have slightly different other parameters, and you will see it later. No, and one of these parameters actually is that it has parameter memory reclaim, and this workqueue is used for queuing some work that is needed to actually reclaim memory, which is the resource that might block creating new processes and actually created new kthreads and new workers. So if there is not enough memory, then actually the workqueues might get blocked. And the only way to move forward is to actually reclaim the memory. And for this, there is a possibility to have this workqueues, and they have one extra kthread that is a fallback, and it's not used when it's possibility to create new workers and when the system works normally. There might be other reasons why the worker cannot be created, for example, when it's out of pit space, or maybe another reason that I am not aware of. But actually, in this case, the system could not do anything about it. Just the memory, it has to, actually, the system could fix it, but memory reclaim. This is why, actually, the parameter to enable the RESTQL is called memory reclaim, memory claim. Okay. Now, this is another workqueue, which will be unbound, so it won't process the work on the same CPU where it was queued. But actually, it's not fully random. It's actually still processing the work items on the same NUMA node. So it still might use more worker pools if there are more NUMA nodes on that system. And again, this workqueue structure is connected with that worker pools by that pwqueue structure. Okay, and now let's do actually some work. So on this diagram, someone queued a work to the workqueue A. And it's actually the first work item then. There, so that workqueue actually, it the command queue command actually woken that one idle worker in that worker pool, and it started to process this work. On this picture, we have another work queued from the workqueue B, which in this for our to show one more functionality, let's say that this workqueue has another parameter that it's intended for CPU intensive work items. So because by default workqueue expect that the callbacks are not CPU intensive, so they are supposed to be relatively quick. They might actually sleep, but they should not occupy the CPU for too long. And if any work need a lot of CPU work, then it should use workqueue with that CPU intensive flag. So I will use the red color for these work items from this B workqueue. Okay, and we will actually see the difference in the next slide, which will show what happens if we queue another work item. We queued one work item on CPU 0, and because it's processing, the currently running worker is processing the normal work item that it's supposed to be quick, that it doesn't wake up any other worker, because it might take actually a longer time to wake it, or even if it would be needed to create another worker, then it might take even longer time than just waiting for the worker to finish the currently processing work. And the situation is different on CPU 1. If we queue another work there, then actually the worker was running CPU intensive work that it's supposed to occupy the process, the worker, for a longer time. So in this case, a new worker is vacant and it starts process immediately the newly queued work. And if we queue even more work items, then actually nothing new happens, and they are put into queue that is local to the right worker pool. And you might notice that this actually the queue is local to the worker pool and not to that work queue, or not to the pwqueue structures. And it's actually means that if you use different workqueues that use the same worker pool, that in the end on this works and will end up in the same queue, and they might actually, different workqueues might block each other or slow down each other. And so you should keep this in mind. And okay, and let's see what will happen in the unbound workqueues that actually behave differently. And if we, it's the same when there is a first work item, but it's different when there is there are more work items. In this case, any new work item is actually immediately being proceeded on a newly vacant worker. Actually, I'm not completely sure about the motivation for this. My explanation is that it's because there are usually just few NUMA nodes, so that actually if there are more users of this workqueue, then there will be just few queues, and it might too limit the progress, the processing of this workqueues, and different workqueues might block too much each other. So this is why this is proceed immediately. Maybe there is another reason, but I didn't found it. And so if we queue even more work items, then it starts even more workers. And you see that actually that pair worker pool queue is basically always empty, or should be always empty, if I got that design correctly. Okay, so that was about queuing works. Actually there is another possibility, that actually it's possible to limit the number of work items that are proceed in parallel. And the default is, I think, 512, which is basically unreachable typically. But if you, for example, use maximum 5, then you might see that we already have 5 work items either being proceed or waiting in the local queues, in the worker pools local queues. So if you add one more, then in this case it will be added to that local queue in the EWQ structure. And it means that this work is blocked and it can be proceed. It's not ready to be proceed immediately. If you add even more work items that they are just put into these structures until some work from this work queue is really proceed and finished. And it's actually the behavior is exactly the same for unbound work queues. If you set some limit and if it's reached, then it will actually stop creating new workers and it will put them into that PWQ structures. Okay, so that was about adding new work items. Another situation that might happen is that actually some work has to wait for something. So that worker actually goes into sleep, and there is a special hook in scheduler that is able to detect that the process is a workqueue worker, and it calls back, it calls some workqueue code that actually checks the local queue of that worker pool. And if there is pending another work, then it wakes a worker and it starts processing another pending work. And in this case, I'm not sure, maybe I should have put it into another slide, but what happened was that on CPU zero, there were just two workers and one idle. And you might see that actually there was created another idle worker. And it's the design. There always have to be at least one idle worker in each worker pool. I am not completely sure about it, but my explanation is that it's because you could create new process only in normal context. So that actually you have to create just by another worker. And so actually this worker, before it starts proceeding the work, it actually creates another worker. And it waits until it's finished, and when it's created, then it starts actually processing that work. And you might see it on CPU 8. There is the situation even more complicated, and it's because if we go back, it doesn't work. Okay, the first pending work was from the CPU intensive work queue, so it will occupy the newly vacant worker for a longer time, so it automatically wakes another worker, which was the last idle one, so it created another idle worker and then start proceeding one more work. So in this case, like the sleeping of one worker actually indirectly woken two workers and even caused creating another worker. Okay, what happens with unbound workqueues here? The behavior is less complicated. It's because actually the local queues of the worker pools are basically always empty. So if any worker goes into sleep, then it's just sleeping and nothing really happens. Okay, so next possible situation is when actually some worker finish some work item. In this case, this worker finished that CPU intensive work item, and there is still running a worker that is proceeding normal work item that is supposed to be fast. So in this case, the worker that finished the work actually goes idle, and just the one that is proceeding the work that is supposed to be fast is running. And I guess the reason for this behavior is that it makes the behavior more predictable, and actually because otherwise there might be only a growing number of workers that might proceed a lot of works in parallel. And yeah. Okay, and on the next slide we see situation when actually it's not visible. Maybe I should show it another way, but actually this worker finished normal work and took another normal work, another pending work from the local queue. So this is what one would expect. On that unbound workqueues, if you finish some work item, then actually in this case it was work item for that limited workqueue with that maximum number of 8 work items that might be proceeding in parallel. So it means that another work that was blocked until this time might get proceed. And if we finished even more work items there, then some workers just go idle. And it might happen that there are even suddenly there is a lot of idle workers. And it might be ugly if there are too many idle workers just because there was some peak of needed work that will no longer happen. So workqueues do some balancing, and they start a timer when they see that there is more workers. And when the timer fires and there are still too many idle workers, then it actually removes the some of them. Okay. And actually, I finally remembered the reason why unbound workqueues are using this, are actually using separated worker for each work item. And it's because they are suggest for work items that are more CPU intensive, and that actually you don't want to balance them by that workqueue algorithm, but you actually want to let the system scheduler to actually balance how they are scheduled and how they are proceed together with the rest of the system, and also against each other. Okay. And now there is a final situation that might happen, and this is where the rescuer is being used. And what happened here is that also the second worker on CPU 0 actually got asleep. So it woken the last idle worker that tried to create another worker, because there always have to be at least one idle worker. But for some reason, it didn't work. So actually the implementation is that way, that it always starts some timer, which is called Mayday timer, before it actually creates the new worker. And when this timer fires and the worker is still not there, then the timer goes through the local queue of that worker pool that actually started the timer. And if it sees there any work item from a work queue that was marked for memory reclaim, then it actually summons that worker that a rescue worker attach it to that worker pool, and that worker starts processing one of that that first work that might help with reclaiming memory. And there is a hope that it will help to actually create that worker. Now you might notice that it doesn't process the first work item in the queue, that it really actually processes the work item that is supposed to help with memory reclaim. Okay, so that was the last diagram. So you might get the feeling how different workqueues behave. And now, if you would want to use them, then you might see that there are actually some system workqueues that are usable for in most situations, and they are basically enough, because if you create your own workqueue with the same parameters, then this workqueue will use the same worker pools, and basically it will not make any difference, because work items from all these workqueues will end up in the same queue, in the same worker pools.
Sorry for interrupting, Peter. I wanted to read the question from the chat. It's Michal Otsko who asks, the work item in run by the rescuer cannot perform or depend by any means on a memory allocation, right? So he has confirmation on depending on memory allocation for this, the rescuer.
Yeah, that's true. You should be careful about it to make sure that these work items needed for memory reclaim actually don't need any memory allocation. And actually, there is one more thing that you need to be careful about, that actually these work items might depend on another work items. For example, I don't know, for some disk operations, there might be some more work items that wait until something else finished, and in this situation you have to actually create a separate workqueue for each of this item, because there is always only one rescue worker, and if some works might depend on each other, you need to have as many rescue workers as many of these dependencies there are, so that actually you guarantee the forward progress that this many work items may be actually being processed in parallel. Okay, so back to the system workqueues. So one common, maybe most typical system workqueue is called system workqueue, and is that bound, so it's bound one with normal work items. So it processes the work item on the same CPU, and it should be used for CPU non-intensive work items. If you actually queue there something that occupies the CPU for a long time, that it will actually block all the other work items in the same worker pool, because they will wait until this work finishes. As you have seen that in this case, it doesn't wake up another worker when there are more pending work items. Okay, another system workqueue is high trio workqueue. It's basically the same like system workqueue. It's also for CPU non-intensive work items, and just that this it uses separate worker pools where the workers have the lowest nice levels, so they have the highest priority, and so they have better chance to work on overloaded system. And then the system long workqueue, and it uses the same worker pools as that system workqueue. But it's so normal priority, but it's used for CPU intensive work items, which means that if the workers start processing this work, then it will wake up another worker when there is another pending work on that worker pool. Okay, next slide. Then there are the unbound workqueues that use that is using the Pernuma worker pools. And it's actually, it should be used for CPU intensive or sleeping work items that actually will create always new workers when they are queued. And the documentation about workqueues say that it should be used when there is a risk that a lot of works might be queued in some waves, so that there might be needed a lot of workers at some point, but most of the time these workers would be idle. But also there is said that it might be used when you actually want to use the system scheduler to balance the CPU access for all these workers when processing these work items. Okay, system feasible workqueue. This is easy. It's this workqueue is draining the workqueue when the system before the system is freezed when freezing. That is power efficient, which basically which behaves either like system workqueue or system onboard workqueue, depending on some kernel parameter. And there is another system workqueue that is actually combining that freezable and power efficient. But actually, this is not that important from my point of view for this presentation. Still interesting might be when you actually might need to use your own custom workqueue. One reason when it actually makes sense is when you want to somehow isolate the work items, either because you want to preserve resources for these work items, or that you don't want to disturb the rest of the system at the official workload with these work items. And just note that this create actually separated worker pools because the workers have another CPU affinity than the standard, the default NUMA, per NUMA worker pools. But still, if you create more custom CPU workqueues with the same parameter, with the same CPU mask, then it will still they will still share the same worker pools. So it doesn't mean that you will get your own workers in this case. They still might be shared. Another reason is when your work is needed for memory reclaim. In this case, you need to use that memory reclaim parameter, and so that you will get that ESQ worker. And you should be aware that you should queue. If some work items depend on some other work items, then you should queue them into separated workqueues, so that there is enough rescuers to guarantee for work progress. And note that actually this problem is not, you normally don't have this trouble because actually the waiting, busy waiting happens only when this process is already running. So there is no problem with creating new worker. And if the worker is sleeping, then normally there is the hook in a scheduler that will wake up another worker. So you don't have these dependency troubles when the system is working properly. Okay, so another reason for custom workqueues is if you want to throttle somehow the limit, because the default is 512. And if you don't want to block too much the other users of the same workload pools, or if you don't want to prevent creating too many workers in the unbound case, then you should use that your own workqueue with some limit. And one more reason is that ordered workqueue, because if you have seen that the works were actually split pair into that pair worker pool, local queues, so it's possible that some worker pool will proceed some work quicker, even when it was originally queued later. So if you want to make sure that you have to use max active one, which allows to have only one work that is ready to use. And there is actually also special parameter that make this immutable, because otherwise it can be changed in SysFS, this max active parameter. Okay, and so then some operations. I will try to be quick. So of course you could queue work. Each work struct can be queued only once. But if it's already taken by some worker and it's being proceeded, then at this point it could be queued one more times. And even the callback from that work item could queue the same work, which is called self-queuing. Or you could queue delayed work and modify the delay, cancel the work, and or wait for it, which waiting is important. For example, if you use that system work queues, so you actually are really waiting for your work items. So it makes more sense to actually wait for work item and not flushing the system working. Yeah, okay. And the operations or workqueues, of course, you could create them. You could flash the workqueue, which means that it will this will return when already previously queued work items from this workqueue are proceed. You could drain workqueue, which will wait until all work items are proceed, and it even shows warn when someone queues another work to this workqueue when it's being drained, which is actually helpful when to find some mistake that you expect that the work should be still proceed even though you are already draining and going, for example, destroy this workqueue. And the only exception is self-queuing. It's still allowed during draining, and it's because sometimes it's needed to actually queue more works items to actually process the original request. And finally, you could even destroy it. And I'm almost at the end. And then some tricks and even a few more interesting stuff. If you want to pass some data to the callback, then you have to bundle the work struct into some structure with the data, and you could in that callback use that container of trick. You should be aware that by the operations internally use some spin logs to synchronize work operations on that work use and worker pools and so on, but they are not like fully synchronized. For example, you could queue the work and cancel it at the same time from two different processes, and in this case the result is unpredictable. And workqueues don't implement any supper for this because they want to work in atomic context, because they are for offloading to work from atomic context. So sometimes you might need some your own serialization, when, for example, draining or destroying the workqueue. You should be aware that during CPU hot plug, actually the workers are losing affinity. So it's not guaranteed that they will be proceed on the CPU when the work was queued. And if your work really depends on this, then it's not just optimization. When you really depend on this, you have to implement your own CPU plug callback that has to drain this workqueue during hot plug. And the reason is that the draining might take a long time and workqueues don't want to unnecessarily delay hot plug. And also there is one confusing thing with return values of this queue modulate and cancel calls. This is Boolean, and it actually doesn't mean success, because they actually these operations always success, but instead the return is useful for RFN scouting, and it means how many times the work will actually be perceived, is if one more times, or actually the number of proceeding will not change, or if it will be one less time. For example, when canceling, it either might really remove it from the queue, or it cancel has to wait actually until the work is finished when it's already been perceived. Okay, and then that was the last thing. So the summary, workqueues are supposed to be easier and more effective than plain kthreads, but of course there are some tricks. From my point of view, the debug messages need improvements, and I would actually like to work on this. So if you have some interesting bugs or problems, you see some problems with debugging, then please tell me or add me into CC. And I'm interested in these real life examples so that I could actually make the debugging, improve the debugging. And I suggest to use as alternative that kthread work API if you really want to have dedicated kthreads, and avoid the plain kthreads as much as possible, because it's really tricky to implement them correctly. Okay, so that's it. Yeah. I hope that's
thank you, Peter. Thank you very much. Sorry.
No. I just hope that everyone is still awake.
We had one question in chat, which was addressed previously. Unfortunately, we don't have time for further question. If you can answer this in very shortly, I have on chat by Irgi Wisner, what is the advantage of waiting for a work item to be processed, the wait call? Why not execute it synchronously?
Maybe I confused it a bit, just that wait call is needed when you actually need to wait until the work is really proceed, and it's actually needed when you are handling some dependencies between work items, or it's mostly used when you are like stopping some service and you are actually going to stop that work, you destroy it even, and something like this. But actually, like in this case, you usually use drain or flush that work you, which, yeah. But in this case, it's like the wait is fine tuning, that you will really wait for that exact work item. and then it will be proceed, and you actually will not wait for the other work items from other work queues or even from the same work queue. The wait has to be from normal context because it might sleep.
Exactly. I learned about Workqueue exactly because I had to run some code that needed to sleep and run in a context where it couldn't. So people told me, Giovanni, you should learn about Workqueues because your code that can sleep should run in a worker instead of.
And it's actually really easy to implement. Like you create your own callback, then you define that work struct, and you initialize it with the callback, and you might just queue it into the system work queue.
It's really schedule work. The call, if I recall correctly, schedule underscore work. Boom, you pass the pointer.
And that's it.
Great. I'm going to.